All right, welcome back, everybody, to The Contrarians. This is another one of our special shows, a panel, a concept, whatever you want to call these things. Our good friend Peter Jones came up with this idea, and I kind of got the idea wrong. So let's see what we do here. I nuanced it a little, but we'll see. It's a whole discussion between these things. So essentially, the idea we're going to talk about here is the top five songs. Peter, you meant sung by the drummer, right?
Sung by the drummer, yes.
Okay, I was thinking written, but mine are written and sung, so whatever. We'll just combine here. But so we're going to talk about how and when the drummers take center stage and sing a song in a band, and what are some of these top songs by the band. So we've each got five, and we're going to go through all five as we go around here. And the guest of honor who came up with this idea, let's start with Peter. Tell me about your five. Do them in reverse order of intensity and preference. Yep. And you love these songs.
We'll start at number five. Thanks. And good to see everybody. As a drummer who's been singing since I started drumming, I always found it fascinating. And I like it when drummers sing, because usually we're buried behind all our gear and don't get too much attention. Singing and drumming is not the easiest thing to do at times, depending on how complicated the music is. So that's the topic. So we want to praise the drummer and what they bring to the mix as a lead vocalist during a track. So I'm going to start right off the bat. We're going to go to 1982, and we're going to go to an album, Dawn Patrol, and drummer Kelly Keegi, or Keegi, however you pronounce that. And I picked the track At Night She Sleeps. I think this is a really, really strong vocal from Kelly. It's a driving track. He's just got one of those voices that's really, really comfortable. It's got a lot of power. He's got great diction and great pitch. And it's not that other track that he sings that we're not going to mention, because we don't want to. So this one has always stood out to me. And I think it's a great display of his talent. I think he deserved to sing a lot more tracks. Especially the way set up on stage with him on the side, that you can see him real easily. So he's facing the audience when he sings, which is unique to their setup. It lend itself to have him sing more tracks. So I Kelly, you should have sang more songs. So maybe I should blame Jack and the rest of the crew and Brad for not letting him sing more. So shame on you. But I love that track. Number four, we're going to go back to 1974, and we've got to go with Secret Treaties, drummer Albert Bouchard, and Dominance and Submission. I've always loved Albert's, and I think he is one of the unheralded players of any band. Not just as a drummer, he's a great composer. He's a good lyricist. And I've always found him to be kind of their little secret weapon. And when he left the band, it really kind of changed the personality and flavor of the band. I could have picked another track from an earlier album, which is a standout as well. And I was also disappointed even later, while he was even in the band, Eric, who I love, kind of took over lead vocals on this. And I just give it back to Albert. Let him do it. So Dominance and Submission on here, I think his voice is strong. It's got a nice, high, clean range to it. And I've always liked his singing. So, and that's a great, great track. We're going to 75. We're going to go to Dressed to Kill. And, I'm sure there's going to be some Peter Chris stuff in here somewhere. So I wanted to, now this isn't calculated, but this is actually my favorite vocal from Peter. The song Getaway. I just love how he sings this. I think it's a more developed melody than some of the other tracks that he's doing. It still has some of his, aggressive, strong parts at the end. You can call them screams, whatever you want. It's just, he's got that beautiful kind of raspy, and they've always said kind of Rod Stewart, maybe Joe Cockerish or whatever, which, is pretty high praise. And I've always thought, just like Kelly, he should have sang a lot more songs. And, but it's hard to get attention, behind a kit the size of his, to have the audience, visually focus on a singer when he's buried behind stuff and not out front. So live, that made that kind of challenging. But on record, screw it. Let him sing. because he's got a super great voice and he should have sang more stuff, in my opinion. Let's go to 1984. And one of my favorite albums of all time, Thunder 7. And I think this is just an absolutely overlooked and neglected masterpiece. This is a stunning, stunning album. And Gilmour, the drummer, who sings quite a bit in the band, I'm going to pick the song Follow Your Heart. He has one of those voices that is so deceivingly difficult because he has a lower timbre and color than Rick Emmett does. And Rick can do the real stratospheric stuff. You get the impression that Gil's vocals are more down in the lower range. Try one. They are super high and they're really, really hard to sing, especially full voice, the way he sings them. He's a great, he does musicality, phrasing. He's very easy to understand. And he just fits right in with his drumming. His drumming or his vocals don't ever suffer. And that's a cool thing. And I think this is a great album. And anytime he can sing is good for me. I love Emmett. And they're a great, great 1-2 punch. When we get to my last one, this one was easy and kind of prompted the whole topic in the first place. Going back to 74, going to Sheer Heart Attack in one of my all-time favorite Queen songs, Tenement Funster. This is so ridiculously heavy. And I love the intro. I love the lyrics. They're funny. Brian May is just all over this thing. His drums sound enormous, but Roger has got this voice that can just cut through anything, and he can sing anything. And he was also one of the real secret weapons in that band, not only as a drummer and a composer, but we have to talk about his singing because it really, really added a whole element that was so instrumental in making Queen sound like Queen. So that's number one. Rattle off a couple quick memorable mentions here. I'm going to mention Baby Driver, Peter Criss from Rock and Roll Over. Love that. Another Roger Taylor, Fight from the Inside, from News of the World. I think that's a great, great track. Albert Bouchard. Yeah, you're getting a pattern here, folks. These are the guys I like. I love Revenge, the Vera Gemini from Agents of Fortune. I think his vocal on that is just awesome. Back to a couple from Gilmour. It was a really tough choice between Follow Your Heart and these two tracks. Young Enough to Cry from Just a Game in 79 is very bluesy and emotional and strong. And the one that was closest to taking the lead was Tears in the Rain from Sport of Kings from 86. I think his voice on that is enormous. And then the last honorable one, we got to get back to the early decade. We got to go all the way back to 71 and Peter Rivera from Rare Earth singing I Just Want to Celebrate, which is a tremendous, tremendous song. So those are mine.
Nice. Very cool. All right. Well, we'll just go across as I see them here. David, what do you got for us?
All right. So for me, coming at number five, probably the most obvious choice of my bunch is Don Brewer's and We're American Band. So 1973, you know, obviously one of the most recognizable hits that Grand Funk, maybe the most recognizable hit for the band. I thought, which I wasn't aware of until kind of looking at this, I thought interesting note that both singles off that particular record named We're American Band charted, and both of them were sang by Don, the other one being The Walk Like a Man. So both singles from that record, both sung by Don. I went with the obvious choice coming at number five, We're an American Band, Don Brewer. Number four, maybe my most contrarian choice of the bunch, I went with a Bangles, Debbie Peterson. She sang early, all great singers. I love the Bangles, a little bit of a band that kind of I like a lot. And they all sing, you know, really great harmonies, good pop songs. She sang early on a song, Going Down to Liverpool, which was a cover song. But I'm going with, from the third record, the right before they sort of parted ways, a song called Be With You, which, so she didn't sing lead up until that last record again. Famously upset, didn't get one of the three verses of Walk Like an Egyptian, but she does get to whistle. I went with Be With You, Bangles, Debbie Peterson, 1991, I guess, from that last record, Everywhere. In next up, third position. So I think a lot like Peter, but I went with sort of a less obvious choice. I went with Eric Singer. I mean, you could probably pick any Kiss drummer, and there's something you could pick from. So I went with something a little less obvious, maybe a little more contrarian also, from Sonic Boom, Eric's song All for the Glory. Right. I think that's a really strong song, probably a forgotten album. I like it, but of the last two Kiss records, I like this one better than Monster. You know, different folks have different tastes. I think the production suffers on both for various reasons. I think Paul could have probably used some help in the production seat, but I think that All for the Glory is a good song. I think Eric's got a great voice. I think he delivers Black Diamond really well live. I think he's sort of underappreciated as a vocalist, particularly in the later years of Kiss, when they need a lot of help in the background. Eric really holds his own. He sings a lot through that set and does a really great job. And I'm glad that he got, you know, some songs on the last couple albums to really showcase him. So I went with Eric Singer, All for the Glory off of Sonic Boom. In second position, I went with Dean Castronovo. Hmm. I went with something off sort of the Journey. There's a lot to choose from, and Dean really can hold his own as a lead vocalist as much as anybody. I mean, the stuff he does live with Journey, doing the classic Journey songs, and then, you know, I think they're six albums deep in Revolution Saints. He's a tremendous vocalist, and doesn't really get showcased a lot. He's been in a lot of different bands, and you know, going back to Bad English and others, and doesn't really get a lot of opportunity to sing lead. But I go back to the Journey album, Generations, which was an interesting record, the last one to feature Steve Aoki on vocal. And I think it's odd because on this particular record, I think Steve has come out and said that his singing when he was fatigued or had a tough time. And so on this particular record, six tracks are sung by not Steve Aoki. So Neil takes one, Ross takes one, and Dean takes a couple, and so does Kane takes a couple. So interesting Journey record, right? Sort of an outlier in terms of, you know, the vocal duties. But I think, you know, Dean stands out to me. So I went with a song called Never Too Late. It's a bonus track that was released on the album in Germany. I think it's a really strong song. And Dean's a great vocalist. I'd love to see him do more. I mean, I could have picked something that he does, some of the classic Journey live, but I tried to I self-imposed sort of a no live stuff and no covers. I tried to kind of work that way with this. But if you don't have the Generations album and you look it up, I don't think it's on Spotify, but you can probably find a copy. It's Dean does a great job. Coming in at number one, I went with Kelly Kagi as well. I didn't pick the obvious choice, which we won't mention. But I did go with a song from the third record, Seven Wishes. I went with Goodbye. It's a song they play live. It's not a deep track, you know, by any stretch, but I really like it. I think that Kelly comes out and sings, comes out, you know, when they play it live, he comes out in front and kind of out from behind the drums and sings this one. And really, I think he does a really good job of delivering this song that Jack wrote, and it's sentimental, and Kelly does a great job. So I agree with you, Peter. I think more Kelly is good. So my first choice, Kelly Kagi. Honorable mention, I'll just,
you know what, David, hold off on the honorable mentions. Maybe we should have left that for last.
I just had one, but yeah.
Oh, okay, go ahead then. Yeah,
I was just going to mention Peter Criss. You know, I went with Eric Singer to be a little contrarian, figuring Peter would get a lot of love on these lists. So I love Peter, and I think Black Diamond is a highlight for him.
Nice. Excellent. Okay, we will do the honorable mentions as we go along.
That's
here. This is great. We're getting some good variety here. We got Kelly Kagi twice here. We got Rare Earth. We got Bangles. This is really cool. So, yeah, some good stuff being brought up here. So Tom, take it away.
All right. Hey, I just want to say, first of all, great topic. Peter, it's good call. I mean, given the drummer sum, as James Brown would say, you know, and it's just, and what's funny is when I went through this, it's like, man, you realize it's kind of a rarity. You know, it's like when you're really looking through your collection, you're like, man, drummer singing, drummer writing. It's like, usually it's that famous joke about what was the last thing the drummer said before he got kicked out of the band. You know, I've got a song for the band. Right. So anyway, but I'm going to get going here. So number five, how about Grant Hart? Charity, Chastity, Prudence, and Hope from Warehouse. I love this album. I mean, I easily could have picked Don't Want to Know If You're Lonely as well. I just love that track. And that's, I just couldn't find my Candy Apple Gray record. So, but this one's great too. I mean, Husker Du, just the back and forth between Bob Mould and Grant Hart with the 1-2 punches just made this band really exciting, because it was like the Lennon and McCartney of Minneapolis punk. He always, I loved his voice. I always thought Grant Hart had a cool voice, you know, really, a true singer, not just like singing one song. He was singing a lot in this band. So really great. And also a co-writer. So just very, very rare. But great, great stuff.
Nice.
How about Bill Ward? It's All Right. I mean, this is a weird track. A weird Black Sabbath song. It's like a poppy song, but he sings it brilliantly. It's awesome. It's like it sounds a lot. It reminds me of Something in the Air. When I listen to it, it's like it kind of reminds me of that track. What was that? I can't remember who sang that, but it was like a
Thunderclap Newman.
Yeah, Thunderclap Newman. That's it. Yeah, produced by Pete Townsend. And this is just Bill Ward coming out of nowhere and singing a song on a Black Sabbath record. I'm a bigger fan of Never Say Die, but I love It's All Right on this. Okay, I also have Roger Taylor. Yeah, you can't, come on. I mean, Fight From the Inside is a great choice, but I'm going with Prime Jive on the Game. Always loved Rocket. Prime Jive on this album. Roger was always good at bringing out, you know, great singer, by the way, and would always do like the real hard rockers, you know, a lot of times. People talk about Brian May being the hard rock guy. Roger Taylor was as well. I think he wrote Sheer Heart Attack too, didn't he? I'm pretty sure he did Sheer Heart Attack.
Yep.
Yeah. So he was like a step ahead of everybody as far as like, hey, the punk train's coming. Let's start writing some heavier stuff. I always loved this trend, you know, kicking off side two of the Game. I thought it was a great, great track. Okay, I always bring up the Police, but I got to do it again. Does anyone stare? Stuart Copeland. I love this album because I love that Stuart's all over it. It's not just a Sting show. You know, Stuart has a lot of tunes on here. And Does Everyone Stare? I just love that track. And it's like a piano exercise that he did when he was kind of like before the band. When he was learning piano, he learned this sort of piano exercise, and it's, you know, I changed my clothes 10 times before, you know, it's like this chords that just keep going in a circle. Yeah. I just love Stewart's personality. He's got a great personality. You know, he does the Contact is another one I think is his, and No Time This Time. So there's a lot of great Stewart stuff on this record, but I'm going to go with Does Everyone Stare as my number four, I guess. And then I'm going to go a little bit of a curveball here. I'm a big Badfinger fan. And there's Mike Gibbons in Badfinger. He wrote some great songs at the end of their tenure. They had a couple albums in a row that happened really quickly, and I think they were probably running out of songs, probably what happened. So they're like, Mike, you got any songs? But he contributes a song called In the Meantime on this album called Wish You Were Here. And it's fantastic. They meld it with Some Other Time by Joey Molland. And so kicks off side two, and it's a very powerful song, In the Meantime. It's a great track. And he sings it too. So it's just like one of those where you're like, wow, Mike Gibbons coming out of nowhere again and singing a really powerful, strong song. So that's my number one, or my number five. I'm not sure how I was doing it, but anyway. And then finally, I'll do one honorable mention, and that is Ivan Meets G.I. Joe by Topper Hedden on Sandinista.
Yeah.
So it's like, I think it's the only song he sings on the Clash let everybody sing, right? Everyone sang. And he sings a song on this album, Ivan Meets G.I. Joe. So that's my honorable mention.
Nice. Very cool, Tom. Wicked. All right, Matt, over to you.
Well, each of you have had one of my drummers, and I was holding my breath that it was going to be the song. So I think I've dodged them all so far, but we definitely had some close calls there. My first one I didn't think was going to be a close call, and so far it wasn't. Which is I don't know if this will show up. So December 1963, "Oh What a Night," by the Four Seasons. So that was sung by the drummer, Jerry Pulci. I don't know a lot about the Four Seasons, but I've always loved that song. So when I was a kid driving around with my parents listening to AM radio, loved it then. Loved it as a young adult in Buckhead, Atlanta, when it was always one of the last songs they play at the clubs at night. And if it comes on the radio now, it makes me feel good as well. So it's got a great drum groove to it. It's a real good bass line, super catchy song, and has a lot of nostalgia for me. So that was my number five. For number four, David, I did pick the Bangles as well. So from the debut, All Over the Place, then the song that you did mention but didn't choose, which is Going Down to Liverpool. That was originally done by Katrina and the Waves on their first EP when they were just the Waves. And but I'm not really a big Bangles fan, but I always liked that song. I remember when it came out, it did get played on like college radio. So that was where I first heard of them. And that was the first song I heard by them. I was interested in kind of that Paisley Underground type of stuff, but more from like the Dream Syndicate side of things. But always really liked that song and really liked her vocal performance on it. I like the way she kind of switches into the falsetto on the "Hey Now" that starts each of the verse lines, and it's just a real cool melody and performance on the verses. So that was my number four. My number three, I'm going to go with the Mastodon, and I'm going to go with the song "Oblivion" from their amazing album "Crack the Sky." So this is drummer Brian Taylor. They have multiple singers on many of their songs, but Troy and Brent Moore took the lead, especially in those days. More recent times, Brand is singing more of their leads, but he's got this great clean vocal which contrasts well with the other singers in the band. And I think it works really well, especially on that song. So that's why that one was my number three, Mastodon. So now we're getting into definitely some more overlap territory. So my number two, of course, I was going to go with an Albert Bouchard one somewhere, and hopefully I'm not stealing yours, Martin, because I saw you poke the album up. So from Spectres, I'm going with Death Valley Nights. So that's a great vocal performance. That's the song. Lyrics are written by Richard Meltzer, the well-renowned and eccentric rock critic who wrote quite a few lyrics for Blue Oyster Cult. Per Albert, this was one that Richard wrote when he decided he had to leave New York and he was moving to California. And Albert kind of pictures him like driving and leaving Las Vegas and driving through Death Valley, going to LA and just being in this, hot, slow, angst-filled place. Spectres has a lot of producers on it. So when they recorded that album, Sandy Pearlman, Murray Krugman, David Lucas, and the band gets a production credit as well. They're all in at different times producing different parts of the songs. Murray Krugman produces this part, the vocal that Albert did. And Albert talks about how he was getting coached by Murray, saying, just think of the most terrible things you can think of. And he's making suggestions that weren't resonating. He goes, well, think about your wife leaving you for some other guy. He goes, oh, well, that happened. I got you now. And and he gives this great vocal performance. It is a very emotional performance. He says he was doing method acting as coached by Murray Krugman on that one. So that was my number two. And then my number one, I was definitely going to go with Husker Du as well. So a Grant Hart vocal. And I went and I did some math and statistics on this because I was afraid, Peter, when you gave us the rules, it couldn't be someone who is really the lead singer. So I did some back of the index card tabulating, and according to my math, Bob Mould sang over 62.5% of the song. So I think we're okay going with Grant Hart for this exercise. And the one that I went with, this is my favorite New Day Rising album by then, and I went with Terms of Psychic Warfare on this album. So as was discussed previously, right? He's got a great voice. He does more of the melodic types of singing in the band. So typically whoever wrote it sang it. Bob Mould and Grant Hart, especially later on, didn't really do much collaborating. They would each kind of do their own songs, and they would usually sing the ones that they wrote. His songs do tend to be a little bit more melodic than Bob Mould, although you have exceptions to that going both ways. But I love the way that he sings, not just melodically, but can also add some grit to his voice as well. And particularly on that song, I love the way he sings the line, "Now all the silver you can steal can't buy a piece of what I feel." And he does it with a real good emotional line. So really like that one. Could have picked a bunch of his songs, but my number one, Grant Hart, Husker Du.
Nice. Very cool. Okay. No honorable mentions?
My honorable mentions would be other ones by them. So I don't want to, I think they're the last two, there could be overlap with you, Martin. So I'll hold that. I guess my Roger Taylor one would have been more of that jazz though.
Okay. Well, yeah, that was one of mine, so darn it. We'll get there.
Oh, no, man, sorry.
Okay, so I wasn't quite sure of the rules, so I break a couple rules here, but also my choices are all strengthened because I didn't know the rules. So I'll get to that in a minute. So my first choice is, or my fifth choice, my weakest choice, is Peter Criss with Baby Driver. I apparently don't own a copy of Rock and Roll Over anymore. So there's my Rock and Roll Over chapter from my new Kiss book. And the reason I picked this is because I thought, you know, you had to be the writer of the song too. So I was looking for what did Peter also have a big hand in writing in. And so this is him and Stan Penridge, but of course it's a great vocal as well. You know, I was also thinking Black Diamond, of course, and, but yeah, this is a good heavy one. Yeah, there you go, from Rock and Roll Over. That's my fifth choice. My fourth choice is Fireworks from this album.
I love it.
I hope I'm getting this right, Matt. So he sings it, right? But he's also the sole author of it. And usually he's working with a vocalist. So is that right too? Sole author?
It's my favorite track from him.
Oh, Matt, you're muted, Matt.
Sorry about that. Yeah, he usually he's going with the someone else for the lyrics, and he's so involved in the just the music part of it. But for Fireworks, it is just a solo credit on it.
And I like it better than Death Valley Nights anyways. Love the song. And I think his vocals really good, because his vocals can be a little fragile sounding here and there. But other ones that, Revenge of Virge, Gemini, Hungry Boys. But I picked this because he is the sole writer as well. And I don't want these drummers to be singing songs they didn't write anyways. I don't want anybody to do that. If you sing the song, I hope you wrote the lyrics. That's the most important thing, I think. I went with that for my, number four. Number three, this is where I definitely got the rule wrong. I went with Phil Collins. He is the lead singer of the band, but he is the drummer. It is a strength and choice. I went with No Reply at All from this album, because this is a very Phil one, right? Phil lyrics and stuff. It's got those horns on it. Obviously, that's not them, him. But I love that song. It's a good, bubbly, interesting, unexpected song from Genesis. So Phil Collins on that. That's my number three. My number two is more of that jazz from here, from jazz. Soul writer again, sings it. We know he sings a bunch of things. What else are the big ones? Modern Times Rock and Roll. I'm In Love with My Car, The Loser in the End, Fight from the Inside. But I love more of that jazz. I love that. What does he get? Only football gives us thrills. Rock and roll just pays the bills. Only our team is the real team. I love that line. It's so jaded, right? It's so cool from him. And he's just such a jaded, cranky guy anyways, I think, from what I hear. I have him way high on this list because he's a great writer. I love his voice. He's probably my favorite voice in Queen. Peter Criss is way up there, as close to my favorite voice in Kiss as well. He's way up the list. And I kind of break the rule a little bit here as well. We've got Bill Ward with It's All Right. And there's also Swingin' the Chain, which is amazing. I would actually pick that higher, but I actually went with Bill Ward in his own band with Straws. And I wanted to pick him because I think his singing is amazing in his solo band. This is the back cover, the framed up thing that he sent out, signed with the back cover of Straws, like a big anti-war song, and I framed it up in that cool ad for When the Bow Breaks, and then I stuck the When the Bow Breaks in there as well. But what I love about him on this list that I find so important, again, I think he's just a genius writer, as he's proven on those precious three studio albums we have so far. And Straws is just a monumental, very interesting song. I believe he drums on it as well, and he's writing most of the music. And he does write his lyrics, and his lyrics are good, so that's super important to me. But I think his singing, it's funny. Tom, I guess It's All Right and Swinging the Chain are two different dualities of his voice, but he becomes this amazing sort of, like, I always call him like the Roger Waters of heavy metal. Like, people don't know how amazing these Bill Ward albums are, how creative they are. But what I find is, just as a singer, he just blossoms. He just turns out to be this really amazing singer with this really neat voice and a lot of emotion in his voice. So there he is as a singer. I guess his entry into this list is through those scant few Black Sabbath things. But I think as the singer in a band, this is as good as it gets, kind of thing. So that's all I got. No, I mentioned kind of my honorable mentions along the way. Anybody else got any other comments? Anybody we missed, or how weird this is again?
I'm just going to throw out one in that wins in the strange novelty catalog category. It's Pressed Rat and Warthog from Ginger Baker with Cream.
Cream.
Watching him do that live at the Royal Albert Hall is just a gem.
It's a stage of the Warthog.
Well, I'll raise you on that one, because doesn't he talk about how to make a proper cup of English tea on Sunrise on the Suffer Bus? So that's him talking through that Masters of Reality.
That's track, really right? How he sings. Album. He really doesn't sing.
Yeah.
It's just such a crazy novelty track. Yeah, yeah. And they even pulled it out live at the Albert Hall.
And while we're at it, we must mention the great Iron Maiden song, the Nico McBrain Tantrum. I can't remember. What's the name of that thing called?
Mission from Harry.
Yeah. Mission from Harry. Yeah. So there's a great one for a great drumming vocal, right?
Yeah, that's hilarious.
He effed me up, man. I was in my solo. He effed me up, man.
Oh my God, I could redo the whole bloody thing. It doesn't fit genre-wise with our channel, but a couple shout-outs. You got to talk about Levon Helm from the band. Holy smokes, his contributions to that is exceptional. And, you know, people may raise their eyebrows, but Karen Carpenter did do a lot of drumming. And so we can, you know, say which came first. Is she a singer who drums occasionally, or a drummer who sings all the time? Whatever. But she's a good one to put in there as well. So
how about the first guy that I ever saw singing behind the drums, Mickey Dolenz?
Yes.
Okay.
So, I mean, when I watched the Monkees when I was a wee lad and he was singing from the drum set, and I was like, oh, that's cool.
He worked really hard to learn how to play properly.
I bet.
And, you know, he set up so uniquely. He kind of played on the opposite side. He had the kit kind of set up mirror in reverse. His hi-hat was over on the other side. It was kind of like open-handed the wrong direction, as if he was like left-handed. But, you know,
let's give a shout out to Dan Beeler from Exciter.
Yeah.
Right.
And I don't remember his name. Who's the guy from the Romantics?
Wally. No. No, what's his name? Oh, I should know it. I can't remember.
You can't think of What I Like About You without seeing the video of him staring into the camera while he's drumming.
He's playing open-handed.
Open-handed. He's just looking right at the camera. It's like right in front of his face, and he's just having a blast, you know?
A spit-filled performance.
Yeah.
Yeah, right. Exactly. And I was going to say, Martin, that, you know, Swinging the Chain, he does a great job on that too.
Yeah, Bill. I love that song.
It's a cool track.
Great riff too. Yeah.
Yeah.
Killer riff.
I love that. I love that song.
Everybody complains because his voice breaks a little in one spot, right?
Yeah.
When he's trying to go high at that one spot. But man, what a monster of a song. Oh man.
Such a cool track though.
Yeah.
Just a quick note from a musician standpoint. I will say this because I think it's kind of relevant to our conversation here. there was always one drummer, I mean, one band who, as a singing drummer, I just couldn't do very well. And it was Thin Lizzy.
Because Phil
sings over bar lines in phrases that don't match up. Yeah. And I can't drum and be out of phase vocally at the same time. I can't do it. So every time
his phrasing is insane. You're right. It's crazy.
I said, someone else has got to do it. I can't sing Thin Lizzy while I drum. I can't do it.
Yeah, funny, so, funny.
Shout out, Phil.
I don't know, David, any final thoughts?
No, I think you guys covered it. Yeah. Cool. I think we covered a lot of different areas. So really good stuff today.
Well, let's wrap it up. Yeah, that was really cool. A lot of good variety there. And let us know in the comments below who we missed. I'm sure there were some. I was having a really hard time with this. So I was thinking, I know I'm going to miss someone super huge, but I'm glad I got that writing route in too, because I think that's super important.
Right.
So cool. So we've got a Patreon situation. You can join Patreon, be part of these panels and that, but let us know in the comments. And you know what? We'll leave you with some homework. Go listen to some Bangles. Talk to you later.